how, in this particular segment of the good governance training, we're going to go to the thorny issue of the legal responsibilities of company directors and company secretaries. Now, you're aware that you have your handouts here where you have a summary of some of the key points, but I'd like to maybe highlight certain aspects of the roles that are absolutely critical. So under the duties of directors then, or trustees of the company's assets, and the common law duties requirements are that directors must act in good faith and in the company's interest and not use their powers for personal gain. Directors must not profit from being a director and must account for any profit secretly obtained. And directors must act with due care, skill and diligence. And this is actually a very important point, that it respects the fact that as board members, we're not all accountants, we're not all solicitors, we're not all HR experts, we're doing the very best that we can. And therefore, it's due care, skill and diligence. And I suppose that point that was made in terms of managing risk, when you put a risk register in place and you take a series of actions to mitigate the risks and to minimise them in as far as you're possibly capable of doing, then obviously you are acting with due care and diligence in terms of the running of your organisation. So if we had time today, we could look at all the different possibilities of how you might make profits secretly from an organisation. We're not actually going to do that today. But when you think about it, that whole need for the integrity of directors comes through very strongly in what is required under our company law. In terms of the statutory duties then of directors, it requires that on their appointment, directors must give the company their name, address, date of birth, nationality and occupation. They must also give details of any other companies of which they're a director, and they should keep the company up to date on any changes to this information. They should also inform the company if they have any interest in a company contract or proposed contract. So there again you see conflicts of interest being accounted for in terms of the legislation. The company should also keep proper books of account, be able to accurately identify its assets and liabilities, and that each year financial statements be prepared that give a true and fair view of the company's affairs. Now obviously again membership would need to be aware of this, which is why you present them at the AGM. The statutory duties of directors also include requiring them to write a report for the members of the company to include details such as how the company is doing, important events during the year, developments during the year and any likely developments in the future. Also, they must arrange to call the company's annual general meeting and circulate a draft agenda to the members in good time, along with other relevant documents, including the financial statements, the director's report, and any auditor's report. Directors must also arrange to keep minutes of what is said and decided at general meetings and at meetings of the board and the subcommittees. That is absolutely a critical point, and it's one that we will come back to in a subsequent segment. Minutes are the record of the legal history of the running of the organisation, and as such they need to be treated very, very sensitively in that regard. Now in the original legislation that goes back to 1963, a lot of the time it's referred to minute books. But in the advent of the computer, and particularly documents that we can print out, it is very, very important, obviously, that the chair signs off in the minutes so that they are an actual record of what has been discussed and agreed by a board. But that point that was made as well about subcommittees and working groups of the board, the minutes of those meetings should also be kept in a central location, because a lot of important information is contained and is discussed at those meetings as well. So in addition, the statutory duties of directors also include ensuring that the company promptly sends the required documents and information to the company's registration office. In other words, that you make your annual return. And if you don't make your annual return, be assured you will be fined. It's not an optional extra, you have to get that in place. It's also very important to recognise as well that if an organisation is not complying with the legislation and there are various fines accruing, and over time there's one problem after another, it can have very serious consequences for the directors themselves. If they're struck off as directors, it could have very serious consequences for not just that organisation but any other organisations of which they may act as directors. So just to bear that in mind. Also, the powers of directors are determined by what is in the company's constitution, in other words, the memorandum and articles of association. And it's for that reason that it makes perfect sense for board members to read them. Now, if I were to ask that of you today, how many of you have actually read your memorandum and articles of association? Well, If I ask you to put your hands up, I'll probably find that about 25% of you may have read them. On average, I find that maybe 10% of a board have read these documents. And there's a reason for that, and that in many instances, if an off-the-shelf company was formed originally, maybe going back 10 years, those original documents may not have been read since. And as I said in an earlier segment, it's very important that you would review your memorandum and articles periodically to make sure that they are fit for purpose for what you need at the current time, but also in terms of what you plan on doing next. So your memorandum and articles is the document, it's the governing document, it's the rule book by which a board manages the organisation. And therefore every board member, particularly new members joining, need to read the memorandum and articles of association. Just on that, if you find that the language that's being used is too legalistic, bearing in mind the nature of the document, then it is possible for you to summarise the key points from that, so that, if you like, it's a summary sheet that you provide to board members in addition to the memorandum and articles, so that they can read the summary sheet and just get a sense of the flavour of what's contained in it and the type of rules that they need to adhere to when they're running the board effectively. So for every issue that arises, there is a communication solution to that, and summary sheets are quite valuable. It's for that reason that I've given you out summary sheets today of the legal requirements of a company secretary and the directors themselves, because there's a lot of fabulous information available on the website, and we will give you access to those online resources and tell you where they are in our final segment in the good governance training that we're doing today. But it's very valuable to have summary sheets that, I suppose, really pick out the key points that you need to consider. And equally, sheets like this with this type of information are very valuable when you're bringing new board members in, and maybe you could include them in an induction plaque. So please feel free once you leave here to share the resources freely, and they are obviously available to download on the web as well from pubble.ie website. In terms then of the powers of the directors, obviously are contained within the memorandum and articles, and members also have responsibility to make some decisions at the general meeting. And typically the key one here is the decision to appoint or reappoint the company's auditor. Now, in terms of some of the other key points that you need to consider if you're going to act as a company director, and that again is coming back to this whole area of integrity, just that it's important to note, if directors help to create a company debt, knowing that the company will not be able to pay the creditor, they may have to pay some or all of the company's debts themselves if this is ordered by a court, as this may be deemed to be reckless trading. So again, it makes sense, doesn't it, that you don't simply have limited liability to enable directors to do as they please, that there is this understanding that reckless trading is not going to be tolerated by any board director, and therefore the courts can take action if that is deemed to be the case. In addition to that, you find as well that there's a very strong administrative feel to what is required in terms of the minimum legal requirements that we have to comply to. So again, it's for that reason that I've included some of the filing obligations that boards have collectively. And the first, in terms of documents, making sure that every company must file an annual return to the company's registration office no later than 28 days from its statutory annual return date, that's its ARD. A company director must ensure that an annual return, which is Form B1, on behalf of the company is returned to the CRO at least once in every calendar year. Now, typically it is the company secretary who will be formally filing this on behalf of the board. And that's why when we talk about the legal responsibilities of company directors, we also have to make reference to the requirements of a company secretary and what that role entails. Now, it's interesting that within company law, the company secretary is the only role that you're legally required to have. The role of a chair or a treasurer, PRO, these are all honorary roles that the board creates. But it's very obvious that you need these honorary roles so that you have a fair delegation of work on the board and that it can work effectively. But typically your company secretary will file the paperwork on your behalf. Second thing to consider on the filing of documents is that in almost every case, accounts must be attached to the return, and generally the documents here we're looking at are a copy of the balance sheet, a copy of the profit and loss account, a copy of the director's report, and a copy of the auditor's report. And it's also important to note that these documents must be certified as true copies of those laid before your annual general meeting of the members of the company, and every company is required, obviously a public company, to hold an AGM. And again, take a look at your articles of association, your memorandum and articles, to give you a sense of how you should be running your AGM, because typically, as that's an important function of the company, needless to say, it has been contained and would be made reference to in the articles as well. So where accounts are required to be attached to the annual return, the return filing deadline is either the company's annual return date plus 28 days or the company's financial year end plus 9 months and 28 days, whichever is earlier. Now, for those of you who are kind of sitting there trying to think, well, what does that mean for us? There's an easy way of working out your annual return date. If you go on to the company's registration office website, that's www.cro.ie, and you use the search facility on the site, you put your company name in, you'll get that information on the screen freely available to you. So along with your company name and address and that and the company number, it will also give you the date that you made your last company return and the date that your next return is due. So it's very valuable sometimes if you have a changeover of company secretary and for whatever reason, people are finding it difficult to remember or to figure out when the annual return date is due, just simply go on to www.cro.ie, use the search facility, and you'll get that date given to you on the screen. So it's very valuable to have that resource available to you. Now, as I mentioned, I think a little bit earlier, where returns are not filed on time, a late filing penalty must be paid and further enforcement actions may be pursued by the CRO. So it is really important that you make the returns on time. And then last but not least, on a sheet like this, it's like a lot of ads on the radio or on television. Just to state, it's the responsibility of each director to ensure that their company is not in breach of the Companies Act 1963 to 2009. So that's a catch-all for this. But typically when you are filing your documents as you're required to, you're complying with the regulations required on this, you should be fine. And obviously work as well with your auditors and with your accountants to make sure that you have all of your necessary documentation in place. One last thing that I want to just highlight within this segment, and that is notification to the company's registration office on the or in the event that there's a resignation of a company secretary or director. So in this case, the company must file Form B10 in order to notify the cessation of the officer's appointment, that is their resignation or indeed removal if that's happened. This form must be sent to the CRO within 14 days of the change occurring. Failure to form or file Form B10 constitutes an offence, and where there has been a continuing failure by a company even, despite demand, to file Form B10 to the CRO to record that a person has ceased to be a director of or secretary, the person concerned may file Form B69 to rectify the CRO's records. But obviously, it's one of the requirements that you would expect of your company secretary that this would happen, and that the information should be supplied to the CRO without them having to go down the road of filling out Form B69. So I suppose when you start looking at the minimum legal requirements that you need to meet, a lot of this is very administrative, which is why we talk about good governance, not just simply minimum legal requirements. Good governance gives you a certain level of added value on top of the minimum legal requirements that you're expected to adhere to. There's one last area, and I suppose what we have talked and looked at over the last few minutes is equally applicable to your company secretary, who is the person who primarily will engage in making sure the administration is carried through on. But don't forget, it is the board's responsibility to make sure that your regulatory compliance requirements are being met. So, you know, you just don't delegate this to someone and never discuss it again. In terms of our company secretary then, there's this little overview, this sheet, a summary sheet then of some of the key points that you consider if you're going to take on this role or you're going to appoint someone in this role for you. And the first here in terms of the role of the company secretary is to ensure that they keep the company's registers. That is a listing of all the members and the directors, and you keep that up to date. So our company secretary will make sure you'll have all the contact details. And the reason you separate out the members from the directors is that a lot of organisations have perhaps maybe 200, 300, 400 members, but they'll have a board of 7 directors. So there's two different groupings here. You need to keep all of those details up to date. Our company secretary as well will make sure that the annual general meeting is held within the appropriate time frame. Now at this point, I also want to make reference to your manual, your technical guide that I referred to in a previous segment, and that is Managing Better Together. So you've got some good quality technical information on that that I would ask you to refer to as well. And that's also available to download from the pubble.ie website if you want to get other members of your board to access this or to share the information more widely. It's available for you to look at there. Also, your company secretary here is going to keep the minute books, AGM minutes and minutes of the meetings of the board, and obviously, as I mentioned previously, the minutes of your subcommittees and your task force working meetings as well, which would be critical. Make sure the accounts are prepared and audited in conjunction with the treasurer, and file the annual return in the company's registration office by the annual return date. Your company secretary will also keep copies of all annual returns and accounts. Now, it might seem an obvious thing that you'd keep copies, but bear in mind that in some community and voluntary organisations, particularly those that are also companies limited by guarantee, you may have documents in 3 different houses. There may not be a central location where it's stored. So it's always important that for this type of documentation, that there are copies and people know where they are in case you have to account for them or you have to refer back to them at a later stage. You'd also notify the CRO of any change of company directors or change of their home addresses. So again, that's a role that your company secretary fills. Ensure that the certificate of company incorporation is displayed. Make sure the name of the company is displayed outside of the premises. Make sure that the company name, registered number and director's details appear on the letterhead, unless of course there's an exemption obtained from the CRO for that. You'll also notify the CRO of any amendment to the memorandum and articles of association that has been passed by the membership at your AGM. You'll also make sure that all legal agreements or contracts are properly discussed and agreed by the members of the board and are kept in a safe place. Now again, what we're not attempting to do is have the company secretary, if you like, at a higher role or a higher level above the board. We're just ensuring by having this role that there is a person ensuring that there was a discussion had on all these key decisions and key, you know, significant decisions on behalf of the organisation, that your company secretary will see this discussed and will see the results of this on the nature of these discussions in the minutes of the meetings, which again is another reason why it's so important to have. And last but not least, your company secretary then is also required to comply with any other duties as imposed by the Companies Act 1963 to 2009. So that's a snapshot of the minimum legal requirements. As I said, in your Managing Better toolkit, you will also get other pieces of information that you require. But this is a minimum, is what is expected of a board when you're complying with company law. As I said, you need to move beyond that though, because there are other legal responsibilities that a board would have, excuse me, not least of which would be that if you are a charity as well as a company, then obviously you're going to comply with the Charities Act 2009. You're also going to have to consider health and safety and employment law, which possibly are the two areas that a lot of boards would have the most discussion around and most concerns around. You'll also need to ensure that you're going to comply with equality legislation and data protection as well. Now, there's a lot of resources out there that you can refer to if you need to, and we'll do that in a final segment on the good governance training. We'll actually take you through where those resources are and the benefits of accessing them. For the time being, what I'd like to finish off within this particular section is actually to highlight some of the other legal requirements that typically a board needs to concern itself with. And I'm going to start and just very briefly today refer to the requirements under employment law. Now, there are a minimum set of policies that you need to have in place as a board once you employ your first member of staff and obviously members subsequent to that. So at the very least, you need to have in place policies related to your disciplinary procedure and your grievance procedure, bullying and harassment, equal opportunities, data protection, maternity leave, parental leave, adoptive leave, carer's leave, emergency family leave, which is also sometimes referred to as force majeure leave, and health and safety. Now, those are the minimum policies required. And when you come back and take a look at the segment related to online resources, I'll indicate where you can get further information on this. So if you're a board that maybe is taking on your first member of staff, you don't need to make up these policies. There's all plenty of information out there that you can refer to that's freely available. And you take and look at the policies that are there and adapt them to suit the needs of your own organisation, making sure that you're doing so in a way that is legally compliant. So as a minimum requirement as a board, you need to make sure you have those policies in place. It has to be said, however, that for most of our organisations, we have additional policies over and above that that we need to have, particularly if we've got maybe issues around Garda vetting, childcare protection. There's any number of additional policies you might have depending on the nature of the services you provide and the type of stakeholders that you provide services and benefits to. So just to bear that in mind, once you employ your first member of staff, you need to ensure that you have these policies in place. Second thing I'm just going to briefly talk to you about today as well, that you would consider as a board, is just how you recruit staff and managing successful staff. Because there's two aspects to that. And really, as a board, what you're concerning yourself with is, you know, how you recruit that most senior member staff. Oftentimes it's your manager or your coordinator, your key administrator, maybe a chief executive, if that's what you have. So how do you go about doing this? And like everything else, there's a series of steps that you can follow that will enable you to do this. The first step is making sure you get the job right. In other words, what actually is the job? Because you'll have a job description, you'll have a job specification, and you'll have a person specification. But what exactly are you looking for from the person? Now, what I would say to you as a board, that when you're recruiting your most senior member of staff, you're not just recruiting someone to fill a box at the particular time frame that you're recruiting them at. You're also considering recruiting a person that can grow the organization for you and equally grow with the organization. So it's more than just the job spec at the current moment in time. There's a little bit more to it. You're thinking about the future as well. The second thing is you have to consider what kind of person would be the right type of person for your organisation. So again, you know, what kind of spec, what kind of experience do they need to have? What kind of background in terms of education or skill base do they need to have for you as well? And equally, is that specification that you've designed for them going to enable you to recruit someone who can grow with the organisation? So that's why we need to separate out the job description from the person's specifications. So that would be important. There's a third aspect you need to consider as a board, particularly in that reporting relationship between your senior member of staff and the board, and that is the formalities around the role. So in other words, what is the reporting relationship? Has that been clearly defined? So does your chief executive or your manager or your senior administrator or your coordinator report to the chair or to a designated member of the board if it's not the chair? That's critical, because you can't have a situation where you have the senior person reporting in effect to 7 or 8 or 9 different people. That's not going to work. There needs to be a clear reporting relationship put in place. And the reason for that as well is that if a person is going to function to the best possible way in terms of their own abilities, they will need to be provided with direction, and they'll also need to be provided with feedback. So again, if you have 7 different people trying to provide direction or feedback, it isn't going to work, and you'll end up with a very stressed out senior member of staff as a result. There also needs to be some work done around just the relationship, because relationships don't just happen, they have to be worked at. And for that reason, we will come back to this in a subsequent segment where we're looking at the specifics of that. It's also very important that when you recruit a person into a role, that they get the right type of induction so that they hit the ground running in the role, and that they have all of the information, that they have the knowledge that they require that's being transferred to them to take on the position and to run it the way that it needs to as well. So induction is very, very important with an employee. I suppose it must be said as well, it's very important that everyone is in support of that person who has been recruited. Now, there can be situations, particularly in smaller communities, where maybe three or four people have applied for a position and all three or four people are known to all of the board members because it's, as I say, it's a small community. One person is selected. Well, that might mean there are a few disappointed board members who may have preferred had it been someone else. It doesn't matter what the disappointments are. When you recruit that senior person, they need to have the support of their board. And there are ways that sometimes board members can subtly undermine senior managers in their roles, particularly if they've had working relationships with other members of staff reporting to that senior manager. So it's very important that the conduct of the board and the nature of the conversations that they have don't in any way undermine the ability of the senior manager to do their job on behalf of the organisation or how they interact with the staff who report to them in turn. The last point that I'm going to make on this as well is just growing the organisation. Irrespective of the person you take in, make sure that you are comfortable and happy that they can grow with the organisation and that they have the skills, the background and the experience to do that as well. So these are just some of the key points that if you are recruiting a senior member of staff, and indeed they are applicable, it has to be said, in many cases to recruiting other members of staff in the organisation, but principally as a board, you're interested in recruiting the senior person who's running the organisation on your behalf. These are the key steps that you'll consider in that process. Just a few other points then on legal aspects that as boards you'll consider. I've referred already to the Charities Act 2009. So again, within that act, as a board, what you'll ensure is that once the regulatory or charities regulatory authority is put in place, that you'll comply with any of the requirements that they have. Just to reaffirm as well that a register of charities will be put in place. And all charities operating within the state must register on that. There will be a very clear and is a very clear definition of what constitutes charitable purposes within the Act. An interesting one as well, just on the compliance side, is that once the regulatory authority is in place, then we will have an organisation to submit annual activity plans to and make reports to as well, particularly on the financial reporting by charities. So once the regulatory authority is in place, you will be getting a lot more information being circulated as to how that operates and what that will entail. And also there'll be new legal requirements around just the fundraising side of it. Now, when we talk about new legal requirements, there is already a voluntary code of practice that has been developed in tandem with this. And again, you'll have access to that through the resources, the online resources that we're going to refer to in a subsequent segment. So again, a voluntary code of what constitutes good practice when you are raising funds, particularly from the public and from donors. So some key issues there. And obviously, if a charity takes issue with the decisions that the charity's regulatory authority will have or will put in place, then obviously there is recourse to dealing with that. And there will be an advisory panel put in place by the regulatory authority as well. So really, I suppose, until such time as we have that charity's regulatory authority in place, we won't go into any more detail on that. The other area, I suppose, that would cause, in terms of concern, or that possibly would keep board members awake at night, would be the whole area of health and safety and doing what you can to offset or to minimise or eliminate any potential risks within your workplace and in terms of the activities you engage in. Now, from the board's point of view, what you need to ensure is and to recognise that you're responsible for good governance, setting objectives and targets, taking strategic decisions and on all the business issues, including health and safety management. But the regular day-to-day management, control and direction of the organisation is the responsibility of your senior manager and the team of people that they work with. So typically, as a board member, you're going to make sure that you have your health and safety policies in place and that the health and safety statements are being implemented, that they are there, particularly as soon as you bring on your first member of staff, you're going to make sure that you'll have your health and safety statement in place. And I think it's also important just to say as well that if you're engaging in activities outside of your head office or outside of the area that you're based in, that you would consider the health and safety implications of that as well. So again, there's plenty of advice and really good websites out there that you can access if you're looking for further information on this. In terms of data protection then, well, I've these next points that I'm going to make are taken directly from the Data Commissioner's website. And again, fabulous resource. But it is important that in some organisations there are data protection issues that arise. And I suppose just listing down the 8 rules of data protection to bear them in mind. First is that you would obtain and process information fairly. Second is that you keep it for one or more specified and lawful purposes and only for those specified and lawful purposes. Process it only in ways compatible with the purposes for which it was given to you initially. Fourthly, you keep it safe and secure. Now, this is actually a very interesting one because with all this mobile computing, and particularly with the advent of laptops, you'll have seen in the media situations where there are confidential or contact details of individuals and the laptop is stolen or gets lost and the information is out there in the wider domain. I suppose one of the things that we will look to in the future is cloud computing, without actually going into that, that you can store all of this information on the net rather than, say, storing it on USBs or storing it on hard drives of laptops or any other devices as well. So for every problem, there's a potential solution out there. But cloud computing, you'll hear more and more about that as the years go on. You'll also make sure that you keep it accurate and up to date, and that's really important as well. For any of us, for example, who send out newsletters via email, then making sure the email address is up to date. For those of us who print out our newsletters, for example, and we post them out to a mailing list, then again, making sure that the mailing lists are kept up to date, that would be very important. Ensure that the information is adequate, relevant, and it's not excessive, that you retain it for no longer than is necessary for the purposes specified. And give a copy of that information, his or her personal data, to any individual on request. So I mean, when you look at it, it's about protecting the rights of individuals, and that's what we're about here. So again, when you're aboard, just to bear that in mind, and I suppose we're not going to go into this topic today, but if you have CCTV cameras, you're obviously storing people's images on them. If you take photographs and you put them on the website or in the magazine, you make sure you get people's permission before you do that, or you take every action possible that you can to ensuring that happens. So when we go through this then, you can see that a lot of the legal requirements are very administrative in terms of what they require of us, but they are important that we follow through on them. And like everything else in life, once you know where to get the information to advise you on this, it's easier then to put the policies and procedures in place that you'll need to make sure that you're compliant. The last thing I'll say on this is that, as again a general rule, that boards would review their policies and procedures, but particularly at board level, you'd be reviewing your policies on a regular basis to make sure that the policies again are fit for purpose in light of the activities that you engage in. So that's where we leave this particular segment of good governance, where we've been looking at the legal requirements for company directors and the company secretary.